So, hi everyone. Good evening, by the way, all of you. So, how is it going up so far? So, I believe it was quite good week so far. And the sessions have been going good. And I believe all of you are able to grasp the knowledge that our speakers are coming up with. Very good evening, Srishti. Hope you are doing good. There were a lot of stuff that had been given in the task, I think. And some people did approach me that they are facing some of the issues with the task. So I would like to know if all of you were able to submit the task on the Slack channel. Good evening, Satish. Yeah, so do let me know if you guys were able to submit your task on the Slack channel, or did you face any kind of issues with them? Okay, and Srishti, were you able to subscribe to the Gravity plan? Okay, perfect. That's great. I'll give 2 more minutes. I think there are other people joining also. Okay, that's good, Satrupa. I would like to ask all of you, apart from Satrupa and Srishti for sure, that were you able to attend the task clearly, and did you face any kind of difficulties during the task that has been listed on the Slack? Okay, I think many of the people are just joining, so let them settle down. Okay, good evening, everyone. There's no response yet. Are you guys settled in? Okay. So yeah, my basic question right now is, are you guys able to attend the task on first, second, and third task? Have you been able to submit them and subscribe to the Gravity plan on Newton AI's platform? Were you able to face any kind of issues with any of the tasks that you had in mind, that you would like to ask or request any support from us?
Maybe we can ask participants just to write like a plus if they got it, and maybe if not, some questions that they have.
Maybe, I'm not sure. But as far as I remember, a couple of names from here did submit their task over there. I'm concerned about the other ones who have not been able to submit their task. So I think they might be facing some issues, or maybe they might not have attended the task so far. So guys, do let us know if you have been able to subscribe to the Gravity plan, and did you guys face any of the issues during that?
I think also we will open a new channel in the Slack, where we would like to ask you to give us any feedback from your
experience. That is wonderful.
Yeah, from your experience during this week and last week, and your experience in platform. What did you find well? Maybe you can help us also to improve some usability. So we will be very happy to receive any feedback from you. Please be free. We are very open to develop and make our platform even more better.
Yeah. And I believe a lot of people have been able to, you know, talk to Elena, I think, and there was, I think even Ilya had supported some of them, and even I was being able to help some of them on a lot of the other tasks. So I think the support is better, I can say, much better, and on the spot, people have been able to get their issues resolved easily.
I'm so happy to hear it. Also, we got some questions about the model interpreter tool. So some people couldn't find it, but it's part of the task, one of the question. So maybe I can share quickly my screen just to give the idea where to find this tool for everybody, and then we can
start.
Okay, so can you see my screen now?
Yeah, we do.
Okay, so we're in the platform now. In the, if we go back, so this is the prediction tab. And when we do the prediction, we can make a view. And here we have the result of the model prediction, okay? This actually our platform is provided as a results. And if you would like to understand the logic behind the model and to use the model interpreter, you just need to choose any row, absolutely, and you will get this button of model interpreter and go to these analytic tools. Okay, so here we are.
I don't show the answer.
Yeah, I hope now it's easier to find, but anyway, if you have some issues with this, please be free to ask our support, okay?
Yeah, I think this should be very much easier for a lot of other people who have been facing some issues with the third question of the second task. So I think this should help them out.
Mm-hmm.
And since this is recorded, I can, because the people who were not able to attend, I can see, I don't see their name as of yet. So I think I can send them out directly.
Yeah.
They should be able to.
We will upload the record from this session and
all
sessions. You can find the YouTube channel.
Sure.
So yeah, I hope it's helpful.
Yeah, definitely.
And of course, we are waiting for the third task also, your own model. So please don't leave it for the last day because at last day on Friday, we will have amazing session from ARM, from Blair Newman about Tiny ML. So please, everybody, welcome. And I strongly recommend you to finish your task before the Friday session.
Yeah, definitely. And there was, Julia, this question had come up from some of the people who had asked me up on Slack. I think this should be a good question for all of you guys also. They requested me to talk about how they can model themselves. I mean, they need to use like yesterday, someone had asked me that if they can use IBM SPSS model and then compare that with our Newton AI, or they need to do it completely on their own and utilize that platform and then compare it with Newton AI's platform. How they can do that?
Well, the idea is to do it by yourself, manually, applying the knowledge that you got or you already have. This is the idea. But we are open also to discuss maybe some other approaches. So if you have these questions, please ask us. Don't be afraid to ask this. For this, we are always 24 hours in the Slack channel. And yeah, and we can answer you on your question.
Yeah, and I believe if all of you have, or maybe if some of you have access to IBM SPSS, or you can say S2, I think some people do have access to S2 also. So if you have access to those, you can definitely put your model, train your model on Google Colab or Jupyter Notebook, keep it with yourself, and then try the same data set on S2 or IBM SPSS and the same data set even on Newton AI's platform. And then you can maybe see the comparison yourself. Yeah. I think that should be a good idea.
Yeah.
Isn't it? Yeah, but we don't recommend doing it for everything because you need to even submit the task.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so, I think we've done with the competition part and some information about it, and we can start, please, with the today's session, I think.
Sure. So, everyone, welcome to the theoretical session on KNN, which will be taken by Vivek. And I think now you can take up the stage, Vivek. It's up to you now.
Thank you, Soham. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, sure. We can.
Okay, great. So I'll just share my screen and then I think we'll start. Yeah. Can you all see my screen?
Yeah, perfectly.
Is it the presentation or is it something else? all right, great, excellent. So that's good news. Okay, so good afternoon, good morning, good evening, everyone. I hope everyone is doing well. How have the sessions been so far? Have you all been enjoying? Just quickly, let's interact for like about 2 minutes. You know, just tell me how the sessions have been. Has it been good, bad, informative? Quickly, come on. It's good. Okay, very informative. That's nice. Very insightful, very interesting. Excellent. Has it been like, you know, too much of mathematics, or has it been a little stressful for you people? I think the idea behind our sessions of late has been always to be, you know, as simple and, you know, as informative as possible. So our major idea was, our team's idea was, to make it as simple and as entertaining as possible. So anyhow, because we've learned logistic regression, SVM, we've learned linear regression, too much of mathematics, I feel, personally, this is my opinion, but I feel that, you know, there's a lot of mathematics involved. So today, let's take this session today a little relaxed manner. I think we should have a little bit of fun also as well today. So I'm going to keep asking some questions in between. So it's not going to be too difficult. It's going to be yes, no kind of answer. So please participate so that, you know, things would be a lot more interesting for you all. All right. A quick yes, everyone, would be nice. Great. Thank you so much. So today, we are starting off with one of the most easiest algorithm in machine learning, which is called as KNN. Yeah. So KNN stands for K nearest neighbors. One of the most easiest algorithm when compared to the other algorithms, because comparatively the mathematical calculations, the hyperparameter tuning, all that is considerably a little low here. So every time before I start learning something, I prefer, you know, having a quote in my mind. This is something which motivates me. So I don't know many of you who have heard of Henry Ford, but okay, Henry Ford is one of the persons who started off the Ford company. So he always, one of his famous quotes and one of my favorite quote is, anyone who stops learning is old, whether he's at 20 or at 80. And anyone who keeps learning stays young. So the greatest thing in life is to keep your mind young. So I personally enjoy learning new things every day. So, you know, keeping that thought in mind, I think let's start with KNN today. All right. Is everyone excited? quick yes would be nice. Yeah. Okay, great. Perfect, perfect, perfect. That's absolutely, that's really nice. Thank you so much. So Canaan, like I said, stands for K nearest neighbors. All right. It comes under the family of supervised learning in the machine learning algorithm. So naturally it implies that, you know, we've got a target variable and we've got a couple of independent variables, which gives the final product, which is the target variable. Yeah. So at the end of the day, the big question arises is which algorithm do we use for classification or for regression? We've learned logistic regression, linear regression, SVM. KNN is one of the algorithms which we can use for both classification and regression. But today, maximum we use KNN is for classification. So the presentation and also the practical session that I've taken is for with regards to classification only. But I will tell you what happens also when a regression problem comes about. I'll just give you a bird's eye view on how it works out. I'll just give you a quick an information as to when you have to use a regression problem, what would KNN ideally do? All right. And one of the major thing which KNN works on is feature similarity. Now, what is feature similarity? As the name states, you know, we look at the features and based on the similarities, how it work out, but we'll go more further in detail. All right. So I have a quick question to everyone. Okay. Have you heard of the statement, a man is known by the company he keeps? Has any of you heard of the statement? Yes. All right. So for those who haven't heard of it, or for those who know it also, it's a very simple statement. A man is known for the company he keeps means that, you know, technically we judge a person based on how on the person that he's with, or on the people that he's around with. A simple notion. That technique is what KNN algorithm is all about. As simple as it is, this is the most simplest way for me to tell you that it's just clearly based on its nearby neighbors. As the name states, KNN stands for K nearest neighbors. So the new data point that comes into the algorithm, based on the surrounding neighbors, it is being classified. All right. Is it clear so far to everyone? At least a small understanding, I believe, of KNN. Yeah. All right. The more further we go in, I think slightly we'll go in detail, but don't worry, it's not going to be too mathematical or anything of that, way. So yeah. So there are, in the most simplest way I can tell you, there are only just four steps which you need to concentrate when it comes to KNN algorithm. All right. So we'll just look one by one, steps at a time. All right. And as in any step, if you have any questions, please feel free to ask. We've got a panel over here who are there to help you. And even if I come across the question, I'll also answer that same thing. All right. A quick yes, no would be good. Yes. Yeah. Okay. Great. Great. Perfect. 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 All right. So in KNN algorithm, K nearest neighbors, the first thing that we do is we have to determine the K value. All right. So now we must we'll be wondering, what is this K value? So this K value, in the most simplest term, is that I just told you sometime back that, you know, the new data point is determined by its neighbors. So now the big question arises, how many neighbors do we have to determine? Do we have to look at all the neighbors around the new data point? Or is it like the closest neighbor, or the farthest data point that we have to look, the neighbors that we have to look? No. So this K value is something that determines how many neighbors that we have to technically look, which would help in classifying the new data point. So I'm assuming all of you can see the image in front. It's a very simple distribution of points. Is it clear for everyone? Can everyone see it? Yes. Okay. So you can see that, you know, in this particular simplest distribution, I have just distributed some green points and some red points. So which naturally means that this is a binary classification problem. All right. We've got two sets of points over here. One is a green class and one is a red class. And the blue data point, which is slightly on the bigger side, That's like the new data point. Okay. So now our idea at towards the end is to make sure that will the blue data point, which is the new data point, be classified as a part of the green class or as part of the red class. All right. So this is the idea behind it. So like I said, the first step is determining the K value. Now, again, this question might arise. How do we determine the K value? That definitely I will tell you as we progress towards the presentation, you will be able to understand. But initially we will take an assumed value. Probably we can take a value of one, we might take a value of five, we might take a value of three, we might take a value of two. That's based on the scenario, how it is that we will see. All right. So is everyone clear with this step? A quick yes, no, a doubt, anything would be helpful. Yeah. Perfect. I'm hearing yes as the answer. So I'm moving forward. All right. The next step is we compute the distance between the data points. Now, when I say we, I'm talking about the algorithm. The KNN algorithm, what it does is from the new data point, what it does is it computes the distance of all the data points from that particular new data point. So all the distance from the existing data points are being calculated. Is this clear for everyone? This is the step two. Yeah. Great. Excellent. I'm seeing yes. Please, if you have, again, I'm repeating, if you have any doubts, please feel free to ask. Okay. I'm trying to explain as simple as possible, so it'll be easier for you to understand also as well. And the more easier you understand, the more better it would be for you to also explain to anyone. Yeah. So once the distance is being calculated, the next step, what KNN does is it ranks the data points in ascending order. So now when we say ascending order, we calculate the distance. Now, what happens is in a tabular form or in a column, the first point would be the distance, which is the closest point, as in the closest distance would be the first point. And subsequently, as we move forward, we would the last point would be the last point would be the point with the most farthest distance. All right. So this is what KNN does. It would rank all the data points based on the distance. Understood? Is it clear so far? We are almost coming towards the end of the understanding of KNN. Is it clear so far? Any doubts in between? Quick yes, no, anyone? All clear? Great. So I'm moving forward, assuming everyone's understanding this. Yeah. Please again ask me questions if there is if you've got any doubts. Now finally, once we rank the data points, yeah, we are going to, you know, identify which class it's going to be. Now, let's say, for example, the K value that we looked into the first step. Now, say, for example, we look at the K value as, say, 4, or let's say we take the K value as 1, for example. So based on the first point, the new data point would be classified. Now, in this aspect, I'm just giving a small mental assumption that, you know, the closest data point, I mean, the K value that we are determining is 5. Now, based on this, the closest 5 data points. So in this aspect, when in the step 3, when we rank it, the first 5 data points we calculate, we look into it. What KNN does is it look into the first 5 data points. And in that, let's say, for example, 3 data points are of the green class and 2 data points are of the red class. So quickly tell me, if K value is equal to 5, and if we've got, like, say, 3 data points of the green class and 2 of the red class, which do you think the new data point would be? Would it be part of the green class or would it be part of the red class? We've got three green classes. Okay. Again, quick question. Among the 5 data points, we've got 3 of the green class and 2 of the red class. Let me be clear again. 3 of the green class and 2 of the red class. If we take K value. Yeah. Perfect. It's not the closest color, Iowa. It's not that. All right. We're looking at 5. So here, many of you have answered it correct. It's green. Actually, most of you have answered it correct. So I'm happy that most of you have answered it correct because you've understood. Here, in terms of classification, the majority. We're looking at the majority vote over here. Let's take in the simplest language. If there are five data points over here, I'm sorry, in the image, we've got three red classes. I'm sorry. So yeah, in this image, if you look at, we've got three red data points and two green data points. Sorry. So as per the image, most of you who have answered, which is if you've looked at the image and you've answered, that's perfectly right. But as per my question, I had mentioned three green data points and two red data points. So I'm assuming if that is a thing, then perfect. Everyone's clearly understood. So far, is there any doubts for any one of you with regards to KNN? No doubts? Is it clear? Perfect. I'm so happy. Yeah. So this is basically how KNN works, the entire algorithm. Okay. So now you all have actually understood what KNN algorithm is. This is the most simplest way you can understand. All right. There are a few prerequisites, a few things which needs to be kept in mind when we work around with KNN algorithms. All right. So let's look into that. But before that, I've got some examples and some things which I would like to share with you. So based on that, I think it would be a lot more easy to understand. Yeah. So let's look into that. So this is one example here. Okay. Again, I've got two sets of classes here, which has been distributed. One is again the green class and one is the red class. The blue is the new data point. We're assuming k is equal to 5. So the closest 5 data points is circled. Now, as per the image, please tell me which class would the blue data point or the new data point would belong to? Red? Perfect. So with this question, I'm so happy that all of you have answered actually correct. I am so happy, which means that you all have understood KNN right now. Great. Now I'm going to show you something else as well. Okay. Now look at this distribution right now. All right. So now again, we have distributed the data points. We've got a little bit more data points right now. All right. So based on this particular distribution of data points, the circled green points, what do you think they are? It's an open question to all. What do you think those three, this is based on the training data set, the points have been distributed. All right. All right, outliers. Let's see, I've got just two answers. So I'm just waiting for nonlinear classification. Okay. All right, everyone, anyone else? No, all right. So yes, again, maximum question answers which I've got. Non-linear classification, no, we're not doing that right now. We've only classified over here into two. So then at the end of the day, these are actually outliers. All right. So my quick question here is that we have outliers. We will be having outliers. There are so many algorithms that we've got, okay, in machine learning, where in which outliers are one of the most key important aspect of machine learning. Okay. Outliers are in certain algorithms, we would remove the outliers. Certain algorithms, we do an outlier treatment to it. Certain algorithms, we keep the outliers because outliers are also a part of machine learning, well, a part of that particular algorithm. So with regards to KNN, all right, again, let's say, for example, here we've got the blue data point. Okay, the blue data point is again the new data point. All right. Now, when we classify it, okay, when we start trying to classify the new data point, we've got an issue here. Now, as per this, the closest data point, you all would tell me that it would be the green data point, correct? As per the image, you all would tell me that, you know, the new data point would be classified under the green class. Yes or no? Quickly. Yes? As per our previous understanding of how KNN works, as per this particular image, you all would tell me that the blue data point would be a part of the green class, correct? Yes, perfect. But technically that would be wrong. Now that's what I'm trying to tell you. You know, technically that is wrong. So one of the main prerequisites as a part of KNN, which I would like you all to please write it down. There are only a few prerequisites which you all need to look into. All right. One of the major prerequisites which you all need to look is that into outliers. All right. Outlier treatment must be done. It should be a part of RED actually. Yes, absolutely true. But because of the outliers, okay, it would go into the green class. Technically, so that's wrong. It's not been classified right. So we would need to make sure that outlier treatment is done. All right. So please keep in mind that one of the most important thing as a part of KNN algorithm before you train the model is to make sure that the outlier treatment is done. All right. Is this clear for everyone? Quick yes or no? Yeah. Yes. Perfect. Perfect. I'm hearing yes from everyone. So yes. So the next quick point which I'm going to discuss about is in our step two, we kept on mentioning that, you know, we need to calculate the distance. We keep talking about distance, you know, that from the new data point, we are calculating the distance. We're calculating the distance from here, the closest distance, the farthest distance, the word distance. All right. We keep thinking about, you know, how is that being calculated? Yeah. So technically, okay. Can you explain the outlier treatment again? Okay. See, outlier treatments, there are multiple methods when it comes to outlier treatments. Okay. I mean, see, in terms of outlier treatment methods itself, if you ask me, there are a couple of things where, you know, you can replace them with, like, say, the mean value, some of them. All right. It's based on the domain. All right. Some with regards to some domain, what we'll have to do is we would remove the outliers, you know. Some of the outlier treatments is that we would remove the outliers. Some of the in sometimes we would just transform those values completely, you know. We would transform the values completely into, like, say, by probably putting up the mean value, probably putting up the median value. It's again domain based. Like, for example, now let's say if you are looking at a medical based domain, outliers cannot be replaced. Those values cannot be replaced. It cannot be removed. So we'll have to work on an outlier treatment on that. All right. But let's say probably there are other examples as well. Let's say like recommendation engine or something of that sort. In that way, we can always remove outliers. It wouldn't make much of an impact. So there are multiple methods of outliers treatment which can be used. You can use, and it's based on the domain where, you know, you will have to utilize which method. Is that clear, Ijaz? What would we do in our case? Okay. In KNN, like I said, see, in terms of KNN, when it comes to the algorithm part, all right, it's again, always one of the major questions which many of them ask is, how do we know which algorithm to use? So we use many algorithms for multiple situations over here. One of the major factor which many of them do miss out is that it's regards to the domain. The domain determines whether how you activate on the missing values, how you work on the outlier treatments. All of these is based on the domain, because based on every particular scenario, things change. You know, every scenario has its own importance on it. So probably when you work on, say, like a construction domain, or when you work on probably on a healthcare domain, or probably on an e-commerce domain for that matter, you know, every domain, they put an importance to certain values. So once you start working on those domains, Anvesh, you would do. So in this particularly, I haven't distributed these values based on a particular domain. It is just a random calculation that I've done, and I just wanted to distribute it. So that's why I just want to let you know that, you know, you need to work on the outliers. All right. So moving forward. Yeah. Okay. So moving forward, distance calculation. Now, I'm quite sure many of you would have read about how distance calculation works. I'm definite most of you would have read about it, and you would have come across many methods. All right. So two methods I've written down over here: Euclidean distance, Manhattan distance. There are even another two methods. One is the Hamming distance and one is the Minkowski distance as well. Now, you must be wondering why I haven't written it over here. one of the major reasons to why I haven't written it over here is because the maximum usage of the distance that is being used in KNN is either the Euclidean distance or the Manhattan distance. Right? Now you might ask, do we use Hamming? It's again on a very rare cases we use Hamming distance as well as Minkowski, but majorly is the Euclidean distance and the Manhattan distance. All right. So let's deep dive a little bit. A slight mathematically, we will look into how Euclidean distance and Manhattan distance work. All right. So Euclidean distance. Now, how the Euclidean distance is calculated. Now, one thing which many people who got into machine learning or data science, one of the most biggest fear for many people is the mathematics that's involved. Yes, mathematics is involved. Yes, you need to know the mathematics behind everything, but that doesn't determine how good of a data scientist you are, because thanks to how the coding works, maximum internally it is being done. But it's good to know how it's been, how the entire system works entirely. All right. So how Euclidean distance is being calculated is very simple. Okay, let's say, for example, we've got two points A and B with the values x1 and y1. In simple terms, we find the square root between the square root of two vectors, the square of the difference of two vectors. I know it sounds long, but then simple as it is, the square root of x2 minus x1 the whole square plus y2 minus y1 the whole square. This is in terms of, say, a two-dimensional plane, all right? Now, when it comes to three-dimension, you might ask, how do we do it? It's simple. It's again x2 minus x1, the square root of x2 minus x1, the whole square, plus y2 minus y1, the whole square, plus z2 minus z1, the whole square. It's simple. Now, a human eye can only interpret three-dimensional data. When we go to multi-dimensional data after that, you know, the calculation is more or less similar on that, all right? This is how the Euclidean distance is being calculated. Is this clear for everyone? A quick yes, no? Yes? Excellent. Yes, great, okay. The next distance that we're gonna look at is the Manhattan distance. Now, the Manhattan distance is very simple, all right? The Manhattan distance is calculated as the sum of the absolute difference between two vectors, which means like for example, in Euclidean, we just looked at it's x2 minus the square root of x2 minus x1 the whole square plus y2 minus y1 the whole square. In Manhattan, it's the most simplest way. It's x2 minus x1 plus y2 minus y1. That is how the distance is being calculated. All right. Is this clear for everyone? Now you might ask, do I need to remember these formulas? Not necessarily, but you know, you need to understand. Now I'm going to just give you a quick question. It would be nice if you all would answer this question to me. It's an interview-based question which was asked to a person who I know. So, you know, I would like to actually utilize this opportunity to ask you guys this question as well. All right. Uber. I think all of you have heard of Uber, right? So let's say Uber in India. All right. Uber in India, which distance calculation do you think Uber uses? Manhattan or Euclidean? Quickly. All right, I've got one answer. All right, we've got Bhargav, got Ujit. Okay, what about the others? Come on, another 5 seconds I'm giving. Come on. All right. Yes, so we've got a multiple answers of Manhattan and Euclidean. All right. The answer is Manhattan. Uber in India, or Uber anywhere actually, because the calculation, like I said, when you look into the graphical representation of Manhattan distance, you would see that it's in terms of blocks. So the Manhattan distance calculation is what is being used for Uber. A quick example, if you ask me for Euclidean, if you want to know, just for comparison, probably I can tell you that for Euclidean, the flight distance between one continent to another continent, okay, the distance calculation is being done using the Euclidean distance. Is that clear for everyone? Yes? All right. So I think we're clear with one thing on terms of distance. Why? All right. Yes, Srishti. Why do you think? Okay. So in terms of distance, when we look at distance, why are we looking at the calculation by Euclidean and why Manhattan in terms, let's say in terms of flight. In terms of flight, if you notice that there are some flights where while going from, say, destination A to B, you might take like, say, 4 hours. But when you're coming from B to A, you might take sometimes 4.5 hours. It's because of how the calculation of distance works sometimes. The distance, how it is calculated is, you know, in terms of, say, kilometers wise, it would increase, it would decrease, although we are going at the same destination. That's because of the calculation works based on multiple factors around it. That's why. So this is how it's being calculated. This is something which I read across in an article, to be honest. This is how I've got this information. That's how, you know, sometimes when we go from one distance to one destination to another destination, the time taken, even though we are on the same time zones, for example, we're talking, sometimes you might say it might be different time zones. That's true. But then, you know, when it comes to the same time zone, there are, that difference is based on this calculation. It's based on the distance again. Distance might be different. All right. So now the next topic, which I would like to talk about, something which has been, which we ran across a lot of discussion yesterday also, is this standardization. Now, do we require standardization to be done in Canon? Or you know, let me rephrase this question. Many of you might say yes, that, you know, we need to do standardization. But my question here comes down to that, you know, standardization. Yesterday, there was a lot of discussion over here. Standardization needs to be done or not done. So just a quick thing, that standardization, do we have to do it explicitly or implicitly in Canon? That's my question. Let me rephrase that question better. Quickly, if everyone could answer explicit, implicit. Do you understand what explicit, implicit mean, or do you want me to explain that as well? I'm okay with that. Is the question clear with everyone? A quick yes, no would be nice. Okay, I'll explain. Okay. All right. So, okay. I'm not clear about the explicit and implicit. Okay, great. So, okay. Then let's stick to this question. Do we require standardization to be done in Canon? Let's stick to that. And then I will come about with explicit and implicit. Yeah. Do we require standardization to be done in Canon? Can you answer that question? Yes or no? No? All right. Okay. Anyone else with any answers? Not needed. Okay. All right. Not required. All right. So I'm going to tell you something which many people, I don't blame you, because, you know, this is how I also understood initially, but the answer is wrong. It is required. Okay. We need to do standardization, normalization in a data set before fitting the model. Now I'm going to tell you why as well. When it comes to a Canon algorithms, what does the standardization do when it comes to a distance calculation? Okay, it reduces the distance between the data points. That's what the standardization does. All right. That's why the standardization has been done. So once it reduces the distance between the data points, all right, the calculation is much more faster. Hello? Am I audible, everyone? Yes. Okay. All right.
Yeah. You are audible.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Okay. Yeah. So like I said, the distance between the data points is reduced when you look into the models, or when we standardize or when we normalize, you know, the data points, the distance between the data points technically reduces. I don't know if many of you have noticed it. If you say, for example, graphically distribute, show the distribution, you will see that, you know, it is been, you know, reduced. Now, once we do that, you know, it's much more faster to do the calculation. All right. Now, why I asked you explicitly and implicitly is because you all heard about logistic regression, linear regression in the last couple of days classes. Now, one thing which many of them might have missed out or probably, you know, when you work out is all of you know what hyperparameters are, right? As a part of the syntax in terms of logistic regression and linear regression. Yes? Do you all know that there are multiple? Yeah. So there is actually a parameter in, like, say, for example, logistic regression. There is a parameter called as intercept underscore scaling. All right. There is actually a parameter. Even in linear regression, like that, there is a parameter where you don't need to actually use the standard scalar or the min-max scalar before you use in the model. In as a part of the hyperparameter in logistic regression or linear regression, you can actually, if you just write intercept underscore scaling is equal to true, it'll first scale the data, as in it'll first normalize the data, and then only it'll be loaded into the model. But so that is what I mean by implicitly. That is what I mean by implicit standardization. All right. But in KNN, we don't have a parameter like that. So that's why we would need to explicitly standardize the data before we do the modeling in KNN. Is that clear, everyone? Am I clear? Yes? Please go to the scikit-learn website whenever you study a particular model, because I think, you know, those hyperparameters would be a lot helpful for you to understand. It'll save a lot of time. All right. Just have a look through it. Now, yesterday there was a discussion that there was a lot of doubts for many people that, do we have to standardize the data before we do a train test split? You know, again, the discussion ended in such a way that, you know, it depends on the person. Okay. It's true, it depends from people to people, but something which I personally would like to, you know, comment on it would be that I would do after the train test split. Now, there's a reason again, which again Promit during SVM had told also, is that, you know, it would be sort of like a cheating thing that we do when it comes to here. But why? There's another question here. Why do people do a train test split before, I mean, why do they do a standardization before the train test split? I don't know if many of you have done practically into a lot of programs, but technically there would be two sets of data set. One would be a training data set and one would be a testing data set, which would be received. You would personally have those two. So this is not like something I'm talking about, a train test split. I'm talking about the fact that, you know, there would be two different sets of data sets over there. One would be a training data set and one would be a testing data set. What we do is that we work on the training data set, and once we do the train test split on the training data set, that's where the validation data set comes into the picture. The idea behind why I told you this is because always the testing data set is a fresh data set which has not been, you know, manipulated, or we've not done anything into it. All right. And we are just, fitting it into the particular model. We're transforming it into the model that has been trained with the training data set. So that is one of the reasons to why I personally would say that, you know, if you've got a single data set, it is better to do a train test. It's better to do a standardization after the train test split. Is it clear, everyone? Or did I confuse every one of you? It's clear? Great. Great, great, great. Okay. So I'm going to tell you a quick tip as well as a part of KNN, all right, or as a part of standardization. You all might be wondering why I said this. A quick tip to everyone. All the algorithms which would involve distance, all right, any algorithms, if you say, which involves distance, all right, or if it involves something which is like the gradient distance, like, for example, linear regression for that matter. Yeah. Please do the standardization. It is best. Your accuracy on the model would substantially increase. The model would be much better. It's a quick tip for all of you. All right. So are we clear so far? A quick yes or no from everyone would be nice. Yeah? Perfect, perfect, perfect. Okay, I'm hearing yes. I'm seeing yes. So I think we'll go into the next thing. All right. So the next topic which I would like to do, which we started off first, is about the K value. All right. So we've got something which we need to find. This is like the one and the only hyperparameter which, as a part of KNN, you all need to look at. We would say this as a K value. If you look into the coding, it would be N underscore neighbors, which would be as a part of the algorithm. Yeah. So this is the only hyperparameter, unlike the other hyperparameters that we do for other algorithms in KNN. This is the only hyperparameter that we need to look at. All right. So in this, one of the major things that we need to look after is that we need to make sure that the K value that we take is being taken optimally. All right. Because let's say, for example, we take the K value, which is high. It would lead to a low variance and it would be high in bias, which would lead to an underfitting model. All right. And if the K value is too low, the variance would become high and then it would lead to an overfitting model. So I'm hoping that every one of you know what overfitting and underfitting is. Yeah. A quick yes or no? Yes. Okay, great. Excellent. So you all must be wondering, how do we find the K value? All right. So cross validation, does everyone know what cross validation is? Have you all heard of cross validation? Yeah. Yes. All right. So I'm assuming you people, I'm going to explain cross validation in a very simple way. All right. Cross validation is sort of like, you know, we find out, it helps us in finding out the best parameters, all right, in a simple way. All right, we've got grid search, CV. Now in this, we've got a K-fold. Okay, so we use basically the K-fold, all right? We basically use the K-fold for finding out the optimum K value. Now, once we do the K-fold cross-validation, we just plot it in a graph, which is called as an accurate graph. So with the help of this accurate graph, you would be able to find out the K value, the optimum K value that would provide you the best, accuracy for that particular model. Tomorrow in the practical class, I will show that to you how do we use the K-fold validation and how do we read the accurate graph for you to choose the optimum K value. All right. But for now, I want you to understand that K value is like the only hyperparameter that you need to look at. All right. It is the only hyperparameter that you need to look at as a part of KNN. All right. And that is something which we need to use cross validation to get the perfect K value for getting our model to be trained perfectly, to get the best accuracy on that particular model. Is it clear, everyone? Yes. Great. So technically speaking, you people have understood KNN is what I'm assuming, because KNN, this is all about KNN that we've got. All right. I tried to explain to you as simple because it would be easier for you to understand as well. All right. There's one more thing, a quick, you know, thing I would like to say is there are some advantages and disadvantages to the KNN algorithm. All right. One of the major advantages that it is simple and intuitive. Everyone can understand. Most of them can assume, like, for example, when you look into the graph, most of you in terms of the distribution, in terms of the visualization, most of you know, I'm telling almost every one of you actually answered it correctly. So it's very easy and very intuitive. Okay. It can be used for classification and regression problem. Now, in this particular point, I would like to just add on one simple thing. Now, we have looked throughout the slides with regards to a classification problem. All right. Now, again, in terms of a regression problem, there is only one step which would change we have looked into four steps. Do you all remember the four steps that we've looked in the initial stages, in the initial part of the presentation? Yes. So like I said, first is we assume the step, the K value. All right. The next is we look into the distance. We calculate the distance. And the third step is we rank the distance. We rank based on the distance, right? All right. The fourth step, only the fourth step changes when it comes to the regression value, when it comes to your regression problem. Can anyone guess what it would be? Like, for example, in classification, we looked at the major vote. We took, like, say, for example, if there were three red points and two green points, you naturally, yeah. Anyone else? I've got just one answer. No? All right. So Satrupa, you are absolutely right. When it comes to regression problem, the only difference is we use the mean value. Absolutely right. Anvesh, you're also perfectly right. We use the mean value. Now say, for example, we take K value is 5. We take the closest 5 points and we take a mean of that. And that value would be the predicted value for a regression problem. Understand? Is it clear for everyone? This is the only difference when it comes to classification and regression. Yeah? Yes? Okay. It's very easy to use for multi-class classification. Now, I showed you all a distribution of binary class classification, which we've got only 2 variables. When it comes to, say, multiple variables also, I'm quite sure you guys would understand, all of you would understand how, you know, it would be based on the K value, it would be easy to do even multi-class classification. Yeah. The next point is one major hyperparameter. I mentioned this earlier, this K value, N underscore neighbors, that is the only one hyperparameter that we need to be focused when it comes to KN. Okay. And constantly evolving. Now, what it means by constantly evolving is, say, for example, we have a true new training data into it. We add a new training data very easily. Okay. Not much of computation is required when it comes to KNN. Very easily, a new data point would evolve and it would change if at all the nearby data points are changed. So it easily, it's changeable. Yeah. And finally, multiple distance parameters to choose from. We've got, like, say, I told you, right? We've got Euclidean and Manhattan. All right. There are, in the hyperparameters, by default, we use the Euclidean distance. All right. Which has been majorly used, but we've got an option of choosing that. We have an option of changing it to Manhattan as well. So that's, again, like I said, based on how the domain, once you get into a particular domain, that expertise or that experience would help you determine which kind of distance calculation you need to do or which algorithm for that matter you need to do. All right. So these are the advantages which is there for KNN. A few disadvantages is that it's a slow algorithm. Now, why I said it's a slow algorithm is that, you know, when we have a huge data set, we've got issues there. When it comes to an extremely huge data set, okay, we've got an issue there because sometimes, you know, if the K value might not be optimally chosen, you know, and the computation of the closest distance, there might be multiple of the same distance, multiple points of the same distance. These are few disadvantages where in which, you know, we have to work on the data set to make sure. So, you know, it's technically a little slow, the algorithm. An imbalanced data set can create a problem for KNN. All right. If the data set, say, for example, if it's binary class classification and we've got like multiple zeros and hardly ones, you know, if we have that, then naturally, you know, the accuracy that we're getting is not going to be right. I mentioned outlier sensitivity earlier, you know, outliers is something which we need to make sure if it's not treated well, the accuracy of this particular algorithm goes in, it does not, is not correct. And after that, optimal number of neighbors, many people have this issue of getting the actual number of neighbors, all right? Because as in the K value, optimal number of neighbors means the K value. The optimum number, if we do not choose, it leads to either overfitting or underfitting of the data. And that is not going to give you an accurate model at the end of the day. So that's why that's one of the major disadvantages, and explicit scaling. Now, explicit scaling, since many of you are used to doing a standard scaler, min-max scaler, it's not going to be much of an issue. But you know, when it comes to other algorithms, you don't need to do that extra step. It's already inbuilt in the algorithm itself. So that has been taken as one of the disadvantages. Is it clear so far to everyone? Yes? A quick answer would be yes. Yes or no? Yes? Perfect. Okay. Excellent. Perfect. So a quick recap on what needs to be remembered when it comes to KNN. We can use it for both classification and regression. All right. Outlier treatment has to be done before performing the modeling factor. All right. Distance calculation, we can use either Euclidean or Manhattan. These two are the ones which has been maximum used. Explicit standardization. Explicit in the sense we need to use separately standard scalar or min-max scalar, either one, or there are multiple more, but then any of them, you need to use it before performing on the algorithm. And the K value, that needs to be optimally chosen. All right. Now, I have tried my best to explain as simple as possible in terms of KNN. So there's another quote which I would like to conclude my the training, as in with regards to KNN, with another quote. All right, is that you don't understand anything until you learn it more than the other, or more than one way. So this is given by another person called Marvin Minsky. He's a computer scientist as well. All right, he's into AI also. He's one of the co-founders in MIT for the AI. So this is another one proverb which has, you know, keep me determined in data science, because, you know, there it's impossible for one person to explain the entire thing. But I think I have covered maximum number of points in the most simplest way for you to understand. But I recommend you all to please read through the scikit-learn in terms of KNN. Okay, just type in Google KNN scikit-learn and just read through it. It's a quick read of say 10 minutes, 10 to 15 minutes. You read it. It's the most simplest way for you to understand. All right. And I'm quite sure that if you just read through it, then you would actually understand what I have explained today. These are the few things which all of you need to keep in mind when you are studying anything. Okay. I hope you all enjoyed the session. I hope KNN was informative to you all. I'm up for all questions if there is anything. Please feel free to ask any questions if you have. Thank you very much.
Yeah, it was actually a very good session, Vivek. Thank you. Even I got so many of the clarity on this. For the distance, I just wanted to ask, there are just two of them. I think there are a couple of more distances also, right?
There are technically, majorly for machine learning algorithms, there are four distances that's being calculated. One is Euclidean distance, one is Manhattan, one is a Hamming distance, and then one is a Minkowski distance. All right. So Minkowski is something which majorly people use in, say, like decision trees and all that. When it's very less, it's not being used much. Hamming distance is basically when we need to find, you know, distance between, like, say, two strings. There are sometimes where we need to find distance between two strings probably as well when it comes to an algorithm. So that's why. But when it comes to majorly KNN, we use these two distances only. As far as I know, my research has not showed me much more distances. But these two are the only distance which has been maximum used. Yeah.
Okay. I read some of the papers, the research papers, which contained Mahalanobis distance also. That was particularly used for one of the neural network that contained I mean, while building the KNN. So that contained Mahalanobis distance. So I'm not sure if that is
and probably if we use KNN with regards to the neural networks, probably, but for a basic machine learning, I don't think.
Yeah. Oh, wow. There is a good question for you.
Yeah. Is there a good test that can be used to select a good value for K? So now, Urjit, there's no test per se. Okay. There's no test per se. Okay. We've got like I told you, the K fold is one of the most widely used. Okay. Which we use to, it's a graph basically, the cross validation, you know, once we plot it, it turns out to be a graph, which would help us in actually identifying the optimal K value. All right. And then, you know, there's no particular test per se. You cannot be like, you know, say 100% sure that this would be. We start off with like, say, K values. Like, say, for example, if it's a binary class classification problem, I would recommend you start with like, say, one or probably three, you know, if if you got like, say, three multi-class, like, say, if there are three classes in terms of the target variable, start off with something even, you know. Yes, I wouldn't say it is. Yes, I had read about this, that it's good to start off the K value with an odd number. Absolutely. It is. I do not deny that. But again, it depends on the number of classes that's there as well in the target variable. Now, say, for example, we've got three classes. Okay, and we give the value as three, or let's say, all right. So then over there, we will have an issue, or let's say we give it as five. And we've got two, and one. So again, we have a question here as to, you know, which class do we classify the new data point? So it depends on actually the number of classes, all right? But ideally, there's always like two classes only. Like most of them, when we look at into examples, it's either a yes or no. When it comes to classification problem, it's either yes or no, you know? It's either yes or no, or true or false, or, you know? So when it majorly binary class classification problems, we use the odd number as K value. It is true. I'm not telling you're wrong. But again, you know, there are discrepancies and there are, you know, hitches when it comes to all that. So it's again based on how your target variable is. Am I clear, Bhargav? Okay.
So I think that should help him out. Is there any other question with regards to KNN, the theoretical part? Because I think we'll be covering up social network ads again tomorrow for the KNN. We'll be applying KNN on it and evaluating the model as well. I think, Vivek, you will be even applying the K-fold validation on it, right?
Absolutely. I'll apply the K-fold. I will graph it out. I will visualize it, and I will tell you guys how to choose the K value as well. All right. So that trick,
hyperparameter tuning also can be done tomorrow, because the data set is not very much big.
Like I said, there's only one hyperparameter which needs to be worked on, which is the K value. A quick example. I would like to also conclude before we conclude. A quick example where KNN is used in the real life application. I'm quite sure many of you have heard of this recommendation engines and all that, right? Like, say, you know, we've got recommendations. So the concept is this KNN is being used behind it. The concept of KNN, if you ask me, is the algorithm used? No. But the concept of this recommendation engines, like, say, for example, your Netflix, your Amazon, when you're purchasing something in the e-commerce website, or when you're viewing something, you get recommendations, right? The concept is based on KNN. It's a very simple concept. So to conclude this, I would like to reiterate on the statement which I said initially, because this is one statement when I read across that statement, if you've understood, then KNN is going to be a cakewalk for you all. A man is known for the company he keeps. I repeat, the man is known for the company he keeps. If you understand the meaning of this statement, then KNN is just a cakewalk for all of you. All right. Nothing more from my side. Tomorrow we will be having a practical session again on social networking data set on how to use KNN. I'm again open to questions. We've got some time, I guess, Soham, if I'm not wrong.
Yeah, we do have some time.
If there's any questions, please feel free. Thank you so much, Satrupa. I'm happy that you enjoyed it. Thank you very much.
It's not just with regards to just KNN. If you also have...
lazy learner. People call it a lazy learner. Now that's a very nice statement, which many... yes, I'm quite sure, Anvesh, when you read it in KNN, we have something called as lazy learner. So, like, say, for example, in logistic regression or SVM, we've got so many computations, so many of them work that needs to be done. All right. So when we are determining the final data point, okay, we're finding a final data point when we are classifying it, it goes through a huge amount of computations before it is being classified. But in terms of KNN, why it's called lazy learner is because there's no sort of computations basically that's being done in the initial stage. You understand? There's no computations as the initial. When a new data point comes in is when the computation starts, and the basic computation that's being done is only the distance calculation. So there is no pre-computations that is being done for training the model per se. When we say we are training the model in terms of logistic regression or SVM, there is no such thing as that much of training that is being done in terms of KNN. That's why it's called as a lazy learner, because when a new data point comes only is when something actually runs around in terms of this particular algorithm. Yes, it completely depends on the other points. Absolutely. That's to simply say it, you just hit it spot on. That's the actual statement. I just was beating around the bush. It completely depends on the other data points. Absolutely. That's why it's called lazy. There's no studying of the data points prior to a new data point coming. When a new data point comes in, only the study happens, and the study is just basically distance. So that's why it's called as a lazy learner.
That's a very good explanation, actually, Vic. Yeah, we are up for 5 more minutes. And you guys have any more questions with regards to the task, with regards to KNN, or any other data sets, or any other thing that, with related to data science? As far as our knowledge, we'll definitely try to answer it for sure. But yeah, we'll keep it to the tasks that we already have. I think the 8th is the last date for this final submission. On 8th, end of the day on your time zone, because I think there are many people from Egypt. There are people from Turkey, from Australia. So I think everyone can submit their answers by the end of the day, so that we can evaluate on the 9th and give out the rewards on, I think, on 10th. Yeah.
Thank you, Srishti. I'm happy you all you could understand KNN. Is there any range for acceptable RMSE value? A good question, actually. There isn't a range. Leila, I'll tell you that. Again, this is where, let's say, for example, I'll give you a quick example on where RMSE can be a problem. All right, and I'll give you. So let's say in terms of a cancer patient, for example. All right. So let's say in the RMSE value, if it is low, okay, as in that determines how percentage, how close the values are, how accurate the thing is. I don't think you need to be. You cannot afford to benchmark in terms of the RMSE value, or in terms of, like, say, for example, if he's got cancer, or if he or she's got cancer, he or she has it. It has to be 10%. All right, you cannot afford to. But when it comes to, say, for an example of, say, a height of a person to find out the weight of that particular person, there is an acceptable benchmark that can be kept. Technically, many people use R2 square is because the value is between 0 and 1 in terms of R2 square. It would help a lot more to understand that. So that's why, along with RMSE, they check out the R2 score and probably even the adjusted R2 squared value. So that, you know, in terms of the percentage also, you'll be able to find out. So absolutely, Anvesh, I would explain to you quickly, tomorrow in terms of the coding. It's very simple. We're using the same thing, but then I will explain to you in each and every step so that, you know, it'll be clear for you to understand, and moving forward also you will be able to use KNN in other particular programs as well.
Leila, I guess with regards to RMS score, the best value, as Pallab has stated, is somewhere around 0.2 and 0.5, and for the adjusted it's somewhere more than 0.8. But that should be a good value also.
It depends again. Like I said, it depends.
Yeah, again, it depends. Definitely.
It depends, yeah. So you cannot, there is no predefined value, because RMSE does not basically come with a range. There's no range of value for RMSE. All right. You know, there's no particular range. Like, say, for example, in R2 score, there is between 0 and 1. But in RMSE, it can be any value. So.
Correct. And also, I think, it can be a high value. If according to the data set, if you consider for some of the data sets, a high value is a very good point, a very good model, you can say. But for the some different predictor value on the same data set can be a very different value. I mean, even a low value on the RMSE will be a good score. So that completely depends on what exactly you are trying to predict. I hope that should help a bit. It completely depends upon the data set and the predictor value that you are trying to get onto. Sure, please go ahead. I think you're typing it.
I think we can wait for another 2 more minutes for her question. Anyone else have any questions with regards to KNN, please? Have you all been enjoying the sessions? Is it been informative to all of you, at least so far? How about the other speakers as well? Has everyone actually enjoyed it? For sure, it's different for the normalized data. The RMSE or MSE for sure is different for the normalized data set. Yes, it is different. See, the MSE is the mean squared error value, and the RMSE is the root mean squared error. So the value would be definitely different. In terms of the, yes, for a normalized data set, it would again be different, because, like I said, you know, when it comes to gradient descent, when we do normalization on the data, the values change, you know. So when all those, naturally the values in terms of RMSE and MSE would be much lower than that of a non-normalized data. So yes, it does change. It would be different as well, yes. Leila, there's one thing which I would like to add on to this. RMSE value, majorly, like, say, for example, when you're working in a company, when you work for a client, okay, they define the terms and conditions as to how accurate your algorithm should be. All right. So let's say for a car company, or let's say for a healthcare or for a construction, the accuracy rate would be different with regards to an e-commerce or anything of that sort. So based on how the company defines, that's how you would actually understand the RMSE value. So an algorithm that you work on, and probably the algorithm that I work on, even though the RMSE value might be the same, but you know, your algorithm might be actually performing much better than mine, because it's again on the scenario. Something which many people don't understand or has failed to understand when they're studying is that the domain expertise actually plays a very huge role when it comes to a particular algorithm. You need to understand the domain properly to actually work on your algorithm to create its accuracy. So I'm quite sure when you start working onto it, you would actually come across many scenarios, and this would be something which you would remember, that you know, there is no predefined set of values. You know, your accuracy will definitely determine based on how your domain is. I hope I'm clear for everyone. It's not just for Laila, it's for everyone as well. Yeah.
Yeah, I think even this thing I have, I did even mention this thing earlier as well, that data science is just a skill. The domain knowledge is what will make you a better data scientist. You just need to apply those domain knowledge and you know, apply those newly acquired data science skill to apply on a particular model, and then build up your model in such a way that that can give you better example or better accuracy according to the domain that you are in. So I think that is a very good point, Vivek, to point out over here, because that is what something people would fail to agree also, because people are, you know, what I have seen is that people are jumping from one industry to different. I would actually suggest that, as even Chris has suggested in the third day itself, that data science as a skill you need to implement. You don't need to take it as a complete industry under, unless you're going for a research, or you can say a better PhD or something like that, until unless in that degree. But in certain sense, that if you are working in, say, payment gateway or something like that, you don't need to shift to something different career altogether. You just need to apply those skills in the same domain itself. So that will give you better models also, better accuracy also, better, it will make you a better data scientist.
I hope our insights have helped you out, that you know, you don't need to look in for a low RMSE at all. It's not required per se. I hope this clears it out. I personally, if you ask me personally, even I do have confusions with the RMSE value. So I look in for the R2 score. You know, I prefer the R2 score, you know, the R squared value, that is. I look into that. It's more easier to understand. So that determines how your accuracy as well, you know, the RMSE value when compared to it. So you don't need to look for a low RMSE value all the time. I hope it's clear, Laila. Yes, Anvesh, yeah. If the target variable is skewed and we need to compute on linear regression, should we need to normalize the target variable? And apart from the linear regression, what do we need to do with skewed target variable? See, now in target variable, if it is skewed, now when the skewed target variable will be only if it is, say, for example, we are talking about a regression problem, because when it comes to a classification, it's not skewed, it would be imbalanced. Okay, so these are two different scenarios. So I don't recommend you to normalize the target variable. It's not ideally recommended, because when you normalize the target variable, again, you know, because the target variable is dependent on the independent features. All right. So we are actually manipulating that. That is technically not right. So what I would recommend you is, you know, try to make sure that, you know, you analyze or you normalize the data which is on the independent variables, so that, you know, according to that is how the target variable would be, according to that, how your model would be trained when it comes to a target variable. So I don't recommend you to normalize the target variable. When it comes to, say, when it comes to a classification issue, then it's an imbalanced data set. So that there are two methods. There's something called as upsampling or oversampling or undersampling methods, which you can use in terms of a classification problem. Based on that, you can always perform in your model. Is that clear, Srishti? Have I cleared your doubt? Okay, great. Excellent. Anything else, guys? Anything else we can help you out with?
Thank you. Thank you so much, all of you. Thank you for being here. Thank you, Vivek, for such a wonderful session also.
Thank you so much. Thank you very much.
Yeah. If you guys have any other doubts, if you guys have any other doubts, please reach out to us on Slack. We are all available over there. And definitely it will be much more helpful that if you can reach out to us even on LinkedIn. In case you are not able to find us on Slack, no worries, you can reach out to us on LinkedIn also. Okay, so we'll be sharing Vivek's ID on Slack also, LinkedIn ID on Slack also. And Vivek, could you also share your GitHub ID on Slack? I mean, to me, and I'll share it on Slack.
I'll share everything. Yes, absolutely. Yeah. And please feel free to connect. We're more than happy to help you out. Yes, and I look forward to seeing you all as well tomorrow for the practical session. Okay, I hope you enjoyed it today. So take care, be safe, everyone, and have a great day. Yeah.
Thank you, Vivek. Have a great day. Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye.